Hey everybody, I'm Dave Sandell.
And I'm Caleb Gardner.
And this is the Best Album For podcast, a podcast where we discuss the best album for decompressing after a long day. Caleb, how many days this week have you needed to decompress after a long day?
What's the old Beatles song, 8 days a week? Like, I feel like that was that was my week, Dave. Now, I know this is the topic of our day, but is using music to decompress at night a common experience for you?
I would say it's either music or it's mindless television. And the last year or so, I've been trying to inch away from mindless television. So it's more often music now than it is anything, or quiet. Like, now it's either more often music or quiet.
Yeah.
That I go with. And my tastes, like my honorable mentions list today is like a half dozen, maybe more albums long. I really struggled to like pinpoint what is the one album because I'm in the mood for different things at different times. But I found that I finally found kind of a sweet spot of if I just really need to like bring myself down, if it's been a hard day, then I sort of know my go-to move is put this album on and just kind of rest for a little bit.
Yeah.
How about you? Is music a way that you decompress?
It can be, but I would say I use it more to de-stress than decompress, if that makes sense.
How do you see like, those as different?
How I see them as different is decompress, I think, happens at the end of a very long day. Like, I guess in my head space, when I think decompress, I think the evening after you've done most of your responsibilities that day. Whereas de-stress to me feels like asynchronous, like that could happen at any time. Like, I'm stressed all the time, you know, like I'm just, you know, when do I need an emergency sedative? The reason why I make the distinction, I guess, is that I don't really use music at the end of the night to decompress, but it's more because if I put almost anything on that doesn't fully engage my mind in some way, I will just fall asleep. Like, yep. Past 9 o'clock is a point of no return for me.
But isn't that a good thing? Tell me how you see that as a bad thing.
I mean, I don't always want to go to bed at 9 o'clock. That's mainly the reason is that I want to, you know, like there's this phenomenon of I finally have time to myself.
Right.
And you want to use it on something that you enjoy and not immediately fall asleep and have to do the whole thing over again.
Yeah, that's fair. That's fair. If I fall asleep early, then I usually can get up early and be happy about it and like actually have a nice morning. So I don't mind so much anymore, although I rarely am in bed before 11 or even 12.
Yeah. So, I mean, sometimes this is true, which is that you end up spending that time on unhealthy things just to like, because you couldn't get in your, you know, media watching or video gaming or whatever right. It is time, you know, earlier in the day. Not that any of that stuff is bad, but it becomes more of a like you're stealing that time away.
Right.
And especially you start stealing it from sleep, which isn't great. Like if it just keeps going.
The whole revenge time. You've read that. Yeah. The whole revenge time concept. Yeah.
But most of the reason why I don't listen to music at night is because if I try to only explicitly do that, this is assuming that you're using that and not doing anything else.
Oh, I see.
I will probably fall asleep.
I would say that for the most part, when I'm using music, that is not the only thing that I'm doing, you know, although the thing that I'm doing can be like writing or putzing around the internet or, you know, sipping a bourbon on my back deck.
Yeah. That sounds nice.
Yeah. You've got that nice deck now, too.
Yeah. I mean, we could do that at night. We haven't yet. We've just because the weather's been turning, we've been starting to use our deck at night, and it's been really nice. But
yeah,
I guess that's a good point. That's a good clarification. I was thinking, what could you sit down and listen to and decompress and just use the music to decompress versus be doing other things?
Yeah, that makes sense. I think so. When I think of decompressing, it's a lot of things happening at once. My entire goal is just to like get myself ready for sleep, like to take my cortisol levels way down so that I can actually fall asleep and not just toss and turn all night worrying or replaying the day in my head. And so I just want something that will kind of like puncture a hole in my stress and deflate so that I can calmly relax.
I like that.
You know, there's sort of this, you know, sometimes I'm reading a book, like if I have something instrumental on, which it's not always what I go to, but it is my favorite thing to go to. If I have something instrumental on, then it's really easy to like read a book or something like that as at the same time.
That I'm often doing that at night, like reading and not always listening to something, but doing reading or sometimes in the, I mean, just in the last few weeks, that time has been my Legend of Zelda time because the new Zelda game is out and it's awesome. I'm not even a big gamer, but that I'm like fully baked, like fully drawn into that world. But I don't, I think my decompression time, honestly, like when I think about this, comes more from when I used to commute from work. Like, I don't think I have a set, like, decompressed time in my day anymore, which now I'm realizing, like, having an epiphany on this podcast, maybe I should build in something like that. Because I used to, whenever I was thinking about, like, music that I would listen to decompress, I, like, where my headspace, you know, I kind of magically traveled to that time on the train on the way home.
You know, that's interesting because I used to bike home. I used to bike to work every day. And that bike home, the music I would listen to then, which I'm sure... Don't get at me about listening to music while I'm biking, but I'm sure that, you know, listening to that music, I usually had one earbud in, one out, that music was definitely always decompression music. It was never like my way to work. I was loud and, you know,
energizing
is the right
tone,
word.
Maybe tone loud, setting for the day. Yeah.
Yeah. It's interesting. I don't want to get into our picks just yet, but you've definitely picked something that I experienced as energizing and not as decompressing. So
interesting.
I want to talk through that a little bit. That's so two questions then. First is, when you think about decompressing, are you on headphones or are you on like music playing in the background of the room?
Headphones. I want something that's probably, you know, drowning out. Especially now that they make such good noise canceling headphones, you can really drown out the rest of the world. Yeah, I mean, but it also goes back to what we were talking about when I was thinking about this topic. I was thinking about listening to music as the thing that is decompressing, not doing an activity and having music in the background. So if I was doing that, then obviously usually would be playing in the room, not on my headphones.
Yeah, that makes sense. I think for me, it's almost always headphones. But then I had a very formative experience at a recent retreat that I was on where it was just playing in the background of the room. And since then, it has become my go-to is try to get it in the room if I can. But it's hard. I don't want to wake the kids up. You know?
Yeah.
Like, it's not loud music, but my kids are light sleepers, so.
That makes sense. I think my problem is that I can't listen to the music and do something else without the music kind of fading mentally way into the background and just becoming background noise. And then it doesn't really matter. Like, I could put on anything that isn't, like, super energizing to our point, and it'd probably be fine.
Yeah. That makes sense.
Yeah. Related, I recently got an ADHD diagnosis, and hyper-focus is a real thing. I'm either, like, hyper-focused on the music, or I'm hyper-focused on something else, potentially. Or distracted by all of them.
All awesome options.
Yep. Cool.
All right, well, let's get into it. Do you want to... I want to talk through your pick first. Tell us about your pick this week for best album for decompressing after a long day.
I struggled with this because I do feel like it's very mood dependent in ways that are both good and bad. Like if I end the day and I'm really pissed off, I'm probably more likely to like put on some metal or something that's like very loud in my headphones. I don't know that I would recommend that. I feel like I have a tendency to like let my mood drive my music instead of my music drive my mood. But the few times that I have let my music try to mold my mood to it instead of the other way around, I think that it has been beneficial. But it's very hard to reach for something that is like mood dissonant, if that makes sense. Like, oh, I'm in this mood and I'm trying to listen to this and it's not working. I'm not grooving, you know? So for this pick, since we are aiming for the best album for almost any scenario of decompression, I really wanted to find something where I experienced a full range of emotions. And I think that's why I went with what I went and why you sense it is energizing, because to some sense it is, and in some sense I really find it decompressing. And my pick is the 2016 album Skin by Flume. This has been my go-to basically since 2016 on several different occasions. There's a lot of tracks here I love. A lot of artists that he collaborated with on this. I think that's what originally drew me to this album. I'm not a huge, as you know, electronic listener in general. I kind of dip in and out of it. And I've listened to some of Flume's other stuff and it's been like only okay. It's been kind of hit or miss for me. But this album really, really does it for me from front to back. And it's been, you know, one that I've really enjoyed. So just to call out a few of the collaborators, I mean, Vic Mensa, Chicago friend. We're on a first name basis. Me and Vic is on here. Vince Staples, Beck is on here on a track that I have definitely gone back to many times. So it's just, it hits, again, that kind of wide range of human experience for me in a way that if we are picking one album for decompression, I think that's why I want, this is one of my go-tos. I mean, if you start on the first track, Helix, and you just kind of listen to the whole thing through, Helix is this very atmospheric and kind of expansive build to the rest of the album. And when I was imagining myself sitting down with headphones and really just like, you know, taking a big deep breath, it felt like a very great start to that.
Okay.
Tell me why
We've never really fully disagreed. I was a little, I bumped up a little bit last week because of the recency of your choice. But this is the first album where, so first of all, full disclosure, I do not remember this album at all. But when I went to add it to my library, it was already added. So I at least interacted with it at some point in 2016.
Yeah.
But I have not spent any time with it. And I know Flume. I didn't understand at first because you buck up against all of my electronic music,
yeah,
seemingly.
Usually.
So when you said Flume, I just went somewhere that wasn't like headliner at Coachella Flume. Like yes, I do know Flume. I'd originally told Caleb that I didn't know Flume. I'm wrong. I did. I guess my argument would be, number one, if an artist can be the last act of the night at the dance tent at Coachella, how can they be the best album for decompressing after a long day? And I guess my second question is, like, how many glow sticks do you have while you're listening to this decompressing?
Oh, come on. Okay. Well, I want to just like, let's pull this thread apart a little bit on this mental exercise. Like, are you saying that no headliners could ever write decompressing type of music? I mean, like, no. There's no Beyonce song that you could ever decompress to, you know, like.
Right, but this isn't best song to decompress after a long day. It's best album.
Yeah, but you're saying that, like, Flume exists in a space that can never be decompressing just by nature of him also doing all this, like, dance hall electronica kind of.
Well, so I spent a lot of time listening to this record this week, and it is... there are moments where, like, there's like an atonal kind of dissonant. It's called I don't know. Are we an explicit podcast? We're launching, I believe, tomorrow. So we can decide today. Are we an explicit podcast or not?
Are you asking our audience right now?
No, I'm asking you.
Is this going to make it? Into
am
the
I
recording?
Bleeping? Am I bleeping cuss words?
I mean, I've definitely dropped a few, so you tell me, do you want to bleep them or not?
There's a song in here called Wallfuck.
Yes.
When I listened to it, I thought, I need an album to decompress from this song. And so...
I love that.
And it was cool. I mean, like, I think everything on this record is cool, and I would love to, like... You know, honestly, would love to dance to it. And
there's definitely some danceable tracks. I'm not denying that. But I guess
I was saying, like, most of them feel like that to me. Most of them feel like get my blood going.
Yeah.
I'm coming at you today because I think it's fun. I do like this album, and I do sort of understand how somebody could use this to, like, decompress, because I use music like this to decompress sometimes. Like, I'll listen to, you know, like, glitchy Telephone Televib albums to decompress sometimes. And so I sort of have a headspace for that, but you don't. Like, you don't listen to that music in the first place. And also, when you listen to that music, you seem to bump up against it a lot.
Yeah.
So... And I do want to ask this question before we get back into it. you really love like Sylvan Esso. You like Flume. Why aren't you like just fully willing to embrace electronic music, man? There's some really awesome stuff out there that I think you would dig.
I don't know. I mean, honestly, like I think I've tried a lot. I mean, you obviously send me tons of recommendations and I always try it.
Yeah.
I think generally I have a harder time with things that don't have lyrics. So sure. A lot of electronic doesn't have lyrics.
Sure.
And on this album, it's kind of a mix, which helps.
That's true.
Right?
It is. Yep.
And he's not really
like screwing with the lyrics. Like the vocal performance gets to stand on its own.
Yeah.
And almost drive the tracks.
Yeah. There's a lot of things in here that are very poppy. I mean, Never Be Like You or Say It, like the kind of, I would say, are the more kind of poppy sing-along type songs.
Yep.
Which, again, gives a great variety of experience from the things, songs like Wall Fuck that apparently you need to decompress from just that song. I mean, but it like, it goes back to me, I think, about how we define decompression.
Yeah.
Because to me, decompression for me, I think, is a combination of like pulling apart the feelings from the day and then getting re-energized again to go do, you know, what I need to do again tomorrow. Like there's a little bit of...
That's interesting.
Yeah, there's a little bit of like I want to feel all the emotions and like get through what I was feeling today. Like you can even get, you know, in the Vic Mensa track, Lose It, you can even get a little bit of that like anger, you know, like I might lose it. Like I'm so pissed about it, these couple things a little bit. So I think that there's... I want to kind of get through the emotions of the day and then feel optimistic again about like what I have to go do next, like the next day. And the other thing I will say that really helped to this kind of finalize my pick is that it ends on this Beck track, Tiny Cities, which is just, it's got this nostalgia to it.
Mm.
Like I've got a playlist called Nostalgia Heavy where when something really, like has kind of a decompression vibe, but in a way that like brings up good memories or like feels very like it has that kind of nostalgic element. I'll add a track to that playlist, and this has definitely been on it for a long time. So it starts with this really build track Helix, and then it kind of decompresses itself as an album, I think, on this Tiny Cities track, which ends it.
Okay, so I think I'm starting to pick it up now. So you're like on a journey, like you're allowing yourself to be taken on a journey through your day.
Yeah.
And if it doesn't empty you out at bed, at sleep, that's okay. Because where you want it to, like, let you land at the end of the night is ready for your next day.
Yeah.
Okay.
Right. Yes.
That's a really different way of like, entering into decompression music than I use it for. So I guess I want to, like, interrogate just a little bit, like, probe a little bit. So walk me through, like, you put this album on with your headphones. You know, maybe just as a mental exercise, I don't know how often you actually do this, but let's say you're just like sitting and listening to this music.
Yeah.
Take me on the journey of this album. Like what, I know you sort of started to do that already, but are you like, are you pacing? Are you just sitting there quietly listening? Like what is happening inside your body? And maybe your mind.
Yeah.
While you're listening to it.
Yeah. I mean, in my head, again, I think this is because I literally was doing this when this album came out, like commuting on the train on the way home, right? So it's not like I'm about to fall asleep, which definitely wouldn't be a good album for, to your point.
Yeah.
It's not anything like that. It's like I just had a really long, hard work day, and I'm using this to kind of like decompress after that before I go into being with family or like, you know, prepping for the next day.
Yeah.
So it's not necessarily that I'm dancing around or really even moving that much. It's that I'm kind of having an immersive experience of one where I put on the headphones and then, you know, like kind of block off the world and just let the music kind of take me through it.
That is so, I get it. I get where you're coming from now. And honestly, if I was approaching this list from that, or these picks from that sense, I would have a completely different answer.
Ah, interesting.
And, you know, another 24 honorable mentions. I love that space, actually. That's probably, like, the space I love most. And where, honestly, where I use electronic music the most.
Yeah.
Is, like, decompressing after, you know, a day of work. Like, when I think of decompressing, I think a little differently than you. And so I guess I'm using the word to mean something different. But if I'm thinking about that kind of, like, ride home from work experience, or just, like, that kind of, okay, now we're putting work in the background and re-engaging with family and other things that are much more life-giving and joyful. Absolutely. I would use an album like this to get there.
And to your point, I think that's one of the mood spaces, if we want to call it that, that electronic works best in.
Yeah, I agree with that. Because unless you're actually at Coachella dancing, as a headphone experience, most electronic music that I enjoy is not, you know, like Skrillex or something like that. It's not, I buck right. up against some of that music. So it's, for me, it's much more like kind of moody.
Yeah. So what is your definition? This would be by a good segue to your pick. Like, what is your definition of decompress? Like, how did what were you thinking about that word?
So for me, when I think of decompressing, I think about decompressing all the way. So like, I think about like my tire is full and I need it to stop moving. So I'm just going to pop a hole in it and let it. And ideally I'm not going to like do that violently. So I'm just going to like let the air out slowly so that I can refill it again the next day to extend this metaphor a little bit. And so when I think about decompressing after a long day, I think about literally the end of the day. So like the kids are finally asleep. You know, everything's kind of wrapped up. My day is more or less over. I'm not going to do any more editing. I'm not going to do any more work. I'm not going to really engage with anybody. I mean, my wife and I might have a conversation, but if I'm going to put this album on, it's for the express purpose of like essentially falling asleep, like getting myself to the place where I'm ready to just let this day be over and go to bed. So my pick this week, which is going to drive all of our clicks. This is going to be our most downloaded episode for sure. My pick this week is the neoclassical crossover album, The Undivided Five by A Winged Victory for the Sullen. Now, that name, A Winged Victory for the Sullen, is so pretentious, and all of their stuff is so like pretentious sounding. But this is one half of the guys in Stars of the Lid. Do you know Stars of the Lid?
No,
they're a Texas band, so I thought maybe you knew them. So they are sort of the they're sort of held up as the most important drone classical music of the last 20-30 years. And so they're like kind of ambient, a lot of strings, you know, a lot of just really quiet, can like sustain one note their albums can be like 2 hours long, and there's very little movement in those albums. So you might stay with one note for a long time before any other element or even any other like chord change comes in. And it's very minimal, but it also does this really cool thing where it swells like from time to time in the song. And so it's like kind of slowly bring you along, and then it like brings you all the way up to reach for the stars in heaven. And Stars of the Lid is not necessarily a band I go to for this experience, because my mind tends to wander a little too much when I'm listening to kind of droney ambient music.
When you say droney, I imagine that's music made with drones.
Oh,
like, is that what you?
No, I did not mean that. They're, oh, okay. They're not flying overhead.
Yes,
I mean, they're droning on. Yes. Like, yeah. Sustained notes.
I mean, not as cool, but helpful clarification.
All right. So there's two guys in this group, essentially. I mean, they're conducting full orchestras, but there's two guys who are writing the music. One of them is named Adam Wiltsy, who is the member of Stars of the Lid. And then the other guy is Dustin O'Halloran, who mostly does, my experience with him before this project was he mostly does soundtrack work or like score work. And so, you know, lots of artsy films he might provide the soundtrack for. And so, you know, they kind of come at each other in a really interesting way where I don't know if this is actually how they work, but there's sort of this Stars of the Lid quality of the music where there's lots of swelling. There's lots of beauty, this really deep beauty. But then there's also this sweeping, like, they're moving a lot more constantly than something like Stars of the Lid does. So they are building these songs that are constantly shifting in some way, but it's all profound and beautiful. They kind of exist in this space between like sadness and hope, which is kind of where I like to live.
Yes, it is.
It's just a little mournful, I suppose. But it has these moments of brightness and clarity that I find just so beautiful. I find myself crying sometimes when I listen to these records. And they have several records. Their first one is much more minimal. It's their self-titled record, A Winged Victory for the Sullen. And a lot of people have probably heard that, even if they don't know it, because those songs get passed around at different TV shows and things like that. And then they have an album called Atomos. Atomos is, I think, probably was my introduction to them, and is, for a long time, I would have said was my favorite of their records. But it is much more like droney. Like, it can stay in one place for a long time, or just repeat the same, you know, series of notes and chords for the same, you know, for a long extended time. And then this is the first record, the Undivided Five. This is the first record where it wasn't being produced for something else. My understanding is most of their work is being commissioned as scores for ballets or art shows, or, you know, different, they have different purposes. But this album, The Undivided Five, was just their chance to create something for themselves. And I just find this music so beautiful and so lush. And I had this experience on a retreat recently, where it's me and my buddy, we were gone for a couple of days. So it's the end of the night, one night, and I was sitting in a chair journaling, and I put this album on in the background, and it was very peaceful and quiet. And my buddy was laying on a couch, and he just fell asleep. And I thought, hey, maybe I also should just fall asleep, like give myself permission to just go to bed. Like, maybe I don't need to be writing and journaling for the next 3 hours and staying up till 1 a.m. Maybe I can just rest.
Hmm.
And I think there was something about this record that, like, felt like it was able to subsume all of my conscience. So I wasn't necessarily listening to it as background music the way I would something like Stars of the Lid. I don't think I could ever listen to Stars of the Lid and you know, not do something else, because it's just too sustained one notes. But this album was moving enough that I was able to just kind of get lost inside of it. And I slowly found myself, like, all the way relaxed and, like, actually decompressed for the first time in really years. And since then, I've used this record constantly at home to kind of get myself back to that quiet, sleepy place. The go-to album for me used to be this guy named Arvo Pärt. So there's an album by Arvo Pärt called Tabula Rasa that I used to use a lot to fall asleep to. And I would, like, have an earbud in, you know, and try to just fall asleep on that one side of my body.
Yeah. I was going to say, does it end up falling out?
Yeah. That album is much sadder than this. And this album is much more warm, much more bright. I find just moments of deep, deep beauty throughout it. And so it's become my go-to, like, just relax and honestly just feel the beauty of life. And that sounds like super pretentious and weird, but that's my experience of it. And their album, their titles and their song titles are not pretentious and weird. Like, they're all irreverent and kind of like,
oh, they're weird, but in a fun way.
Yeah,
that was the first thing that I noticed when you sent me this album, because I was like, oh, you're right, a winged, I assume you say that, a winged victory for the Sullen, because, you know, you need to add up just that little extra accent for more pretension. But oh man, the haunted Victorian pencil, a minor fifth is made of phantoms, or my personal favorite, aqua lung motherfucker. These are great song titles.
Yeah, so they're definitely like, they're kind of living in the classical space, but they are irreverent about it, and they're not beholden to
everything. Seems like they don't take themselves too seriously.
Yeah, but their music is very, I mean, it's very serious. I mean, it's not whimsical. But I just find that they're doing something that, there's lots of bands like this. Like, you know, there's hundreds of artists who are making this kind of music, and they just, for me, are it.
Yeah.
One of my deep sadnesses about the pandemic was that I was supposed to go see these guys in a really small church on the south side of Chicago. And it got canceled and never rescheduled.
Oh, that would have been a really cool experience.
So tell me about your experience with this album.
I mean, I'm going to be honest, like, you sent me this and I was like, okay, this is interesting. And I put on the first track and got about halfway through and I was like, I get it.
Fair. That's and fair. I think,
so no, but here's the thing is that this makes sense about why we, like, define decompression differently, is because I fall asleep super easily. I always have.
I never
and
do.
And so my again, past 9, my goal is not to fall asleep. My goal is to stay awake long enough to enjoy my evening. So yeah. Like, if I put something on like this, I would get halfway through a track. I don't even think I'd get halfway through a track before I would be out. And I mean, this is why I don't listen to music really when I go to bed, because I know that I'm going to be asleep so fast, I'm not going to hear it anyway.
Yeah.
And that's probably true of no matter what music I would put on, because I'm like, my body just always out. So if I'm looking to decompress, I'm looking to decompress my mind.
Yes.
And not necessarily my body. My body's like, when you're ready to sleep, I am. You know?
So I do not, it has often taken me hours to fall asleep. Like, I'll lay down in bed and 2 or 3 hours later, I'm still awake.
Yeah, you've told me.
And not doing anything, you know, just lying there.
Yeah.
And it's gotten better as I've gotten older. I think that I've discovered for myself in the last several years is that I need exercise, I need to read, and I need sleep. And I used to not take as seriously how badly I needed sleep. Mm. And so if there's anything I can use to get me to sleep before 11, that is like, you know,
it's worth this weight in gold. And you're not, I mean, that's a common experience. You're not the only one, obviously. And this kind of music I could definitely see as being really helpful for that in terms of decompressing while like experiencing beauty to some extent, or like remembering how beautiful life is. Like, I love that idea of, you're right, not something that's droney, love that phrase of yours, and you know, ambient, which is, by the way, how this album's labeled in my album,
music,
ambient, not necessarily electronic, which I think is interesting. But without being hopeless, like with still maintaining that like sense of beauty and wonder about the world. Like, I love being in that kind of mental state as you're falling asleep.
I find that, you know, I've tried, I'm not very well versed in classical music. Are you? Do you have a history of listening to classical music and knowing composers and stuff?
Not really. I mean, I will definitely like, I minored in music in college and had to study plenty of classical and opera, by the way, which is maybe one day I'll choose an opera as my best album for something, because I think I know that genre.
I think it's going to be best album for listening to opera.
Some opera is very good for decompression, especially if you want to fall asleep. Anyway, but no, I, in general, I'm definitely not a classical music aficionado.
I've tried many times, and my experience is that this is going to sound, I'm probably, a lot of people are going to be annoyed with me after I say this. Sometimes I go into something because I just really like one little section of a symphony. And I think that section is so beautiful and profound. And so I try to like situate it within the rest of the symphony, and I try to really like take that in, and it's so all over the place, and it's the highs and lows of it are so all over the place and so intense that I just lose interest. I understand that it's amazing music. I get it. And I think if I was listening to it live and watching people perform it, I think I could get much further along with it than I've been able to just listen to it at home. But there are very few symphonies that I have tried to listen to where I actually like am happy I'm listening to them still 20 minutes in.
Yeah.
And most of the time, the section that has been, you know, pulled out and quoted and used in movies and TV,
it's pulled out
because
melodies.
Yeah, it's pulled out because it's like that kind of, you know, dark, warm, beautiful section. And the rest of it is all staccato and craziness. And, right. And so I'm like, well, I wanted more of this. I just want one artist who makes, you know, 60-minute long symphonies where it's just quiet, or it's just soft, or it's just exciting. I don't care which it is. But, you know, and so I've like messed around with some of the like Eric Satie records, the like his nocturnes and different things like that, where you kind of stay in one place. But even there, like, he'll go from like something deep and moving and beautiful to like something do. I'm like, what's happening? How is this part of the same idea? And so with things like A Wing Victory for the Sullen, I find that they maintain the same mood for an hour, which I actually see as a feature, not a bug.
right.
And there's other artists like Johan Johansson, I mean, there's so many other artists who are making this type of music and reach the same heights of beauty. but are also like doing a lot of atonal work and doing a lot of like dissonance work that I find unlistenable. Like if I'm trying to use it to decompress, it's very hard to buck up against a section of music that's, you know, meant to like make you feel paranoid or out of whack or like something is off. I don't actually want that experience. And so I was telling you, we were talking about this yesterday a little bit.
Yep.
Like I just, I like a lot of experimental music, but when it gets too like dissonant, I sometimes reach for the skip button. Like I don't stay with it very long. So I think one of the things I love about this record is that it is a sustained mood for a long time. And that mood is for me, beauty and warmth I love this record. I'm actually kind of bummed out that you didn't, or you weren't. I mean, I get why you weren't able to, but that you weren't able to find your way into this and like have it change your life. My suspicion is that most of our listeners will also have your experience of like, okay, I get it. But for those four or five of you who love this record, hit me up, because I think this is just as good as it gets.
I do think the in-person experience would make a huge difference to me. I mean, I think that's true of all like non-lyrical, more classical or ambient style music for me. Mm. I can have a really great experience and really be into it in person. But I just, there's not a like time and place in my day-to-day life where I want to put it on and listen to it and engage with it. You know what it is? This kind of music to me is like a baseball game. Am I going to put it on in the background and like sit and wait for the pitch and wait? And it's just like, oh God, this is okay. Let's get on with it. Okay. I get it.
Yeah.
But going to a baseball game is really fun. And it's like a full sensory experience. You get the, like, you get the game, but you also get the hot dogs and you get the, you know, you get the whole, it's like a whole body experience, you know?
Okay. I get it. I see where you're coming from. Yeah. I definitely have, I would say, you know, like my beloved DJ Kacey, like makes music that I would use to do the thing that you're doing. Like I probably would have picked one of his records this week. If I was thinking about doing the thing that you were going to try to do.
Yeah, like my definition of decompress.
Do you have a go-to, I mean, even if it's not your like definitive best album for, do you have music that you use to go all the way to sleep? Sounds like you don't.
I don't need it. Yeah. I really don't. And like I said, whenever I go, I sit down, whenever I basically give my brain permission to go to sleep, it shuts off. Like, gosh, it's wild.
That's crazy.
Yeah.
Especially if you have an ADHD diagnosis.
I know. That's what's weird, is that it doesn't affect my sleep at all. Like, that was one of the questions they kept asking me about. It really doesn't. Like, I remember last night, like, literally, I got into bed. And I remember, like, talking to Caroline and rolling over, and that's the last thing I remember.
It's see, Verity, like, my wife is like that. Verity's like that. She'll fall asleep halfway through a conversation, or, you know, just suddenly be asleep. And I'm so jealous. Like, it just looks so good. I mean, my friend I was on the retreat with fell asleep so easily. And I was like, oh, that's an option.
that's the thing
that I can do tonight. I don't have to stay up and watch four movies.
Yeah.
All right. So thinking about these two records, Flume and The Undivided Five, Caleb, is Flume in your personal canon?
You know, I don't know if you would expect this, but I actually think this record is in my personal canon.
No way.
I think that I have spent that much time with it. And again, it's wild because the rest of Flume to me is like, oh, this is fun and like kind of okay. But something just really clicks for me about this particular record. Maybe it's, you know, some of my favorite artists also being on it. Maybe it's the nice mix of like poppy and electronic and the, you know, mood journey. But I think this would might make it.
All right. Well, obviously, you know, Skin isn't in my canon. I don't know if it can live in the Dave and Caleb canon. Therefore. I don't think it gets the nod. My best guess, based on our conversation, is that my record is also not in your canon. It is in my canon. So I am officially
Bringing
in. This is actually my favorite Wing Victory for the Sullen record. I think something that I realized recently is there are about five artists who, if I hear they're putting out a new album, it like goes on my calendar and I like you know, anticipate it for months and months and months. And they are actually one of those five artists.
Fascinating.
So this being my favorite record of theirs is a big deal. There's probably other ones that felt more immediate. This one grew on me more, but I return to this all the time. I listen to this record. I mean, maybe more than most other records that I own. So Undivided
that,
five.
It's in that relaxing. It's like, is it because it's functional for you? Is that why?
No, I think it's extraordinary. I think it's way more than just relaxing. I think that this music is moving and, profound.
What do we do when we split the canon like this? Is this the first time this has ever happened?
No, definitely not. I think that, well, maybe the first time that we've actually like split. Yeah, that's probably true.
Yeah,
we've had things that have like just gone in yours.
Is this like a Siskel and Ebert situation where, you know, it's like one person does a thumbs up and the other a thumbs down, and you know, you as the movie watcher, it's like, what do I do now?
Yeah, I mean, I always vibed with Ebert more than Siskel, and review wise, but personality wise, I vibed with Siskel. So I always felt like I should like Siskel's movies more. If he didn't like something, I shouldn't like it.
That's really interesting.
Turns out actually Ebert's was my speed.
Yeah.
I would say
for the young people, Siskel and Ebert were movie reviewers.
We always find new ways to date ourselves.
I know. It's insane. Anyway.
So I would say at the end of this project, we'll have a Dave canon and a Caleb canon and a Dave and Caleb canon.
And then a massive Venn diagram of a lot of overlap.
And that Venn diagram, John Venn will be very proud of us because our Venns will be. Yep. Well, let's get into honorable mentions. My list is probably, there's probably a couple things in here that you would like. For the most part, this is music I'm using to go all the way to sleep. So I'll kind of mention those first. So like Bill Callahan's Apocalypse is a record I thought about doing. Kacey Musgraves' Golden Hour, I find really helpful for just like really, you know, sitting with some bourbon and sipping it some of this alt country stuff, like Neko Case's Blacklisted, like classic old album. And then there's a couple like that are a couple albums by Morphine. Do you know Morphine? Do you know the band Morphine?
I don't think
they're
so.
A 90s alternative band that we should talk about sometime. They kind of like, it's all like kind of seedy bar music. Can't decide what to do with your life. I just don't know what it is that's right. I just don't know what to do. It's a guy named Mark Sandman who has a really interesting kind of baritone, tenorish, I don't know, one of them, voice. And his bass and like an electric bass. And then a baritone saxophone and drums. And that's all the instrumentation. And it's just rollicking sometimes. And it's really, really cool. So he has, there have a, they have a few albums that are really wonderful, but Cure for Pain or Yes are the albums that I go to for decompression. And then along your lines, a couple one that maybe could work for you. This album called Sinner by Moodymann. A couple hip hop records, Anime, Trauma, and Divorce by Open Mike Eagle, who I called Iron Mike Eagle in our first episode.
Oh, did you?
Uh-huh.
That's funny.
So not Mike Tyson, Open Mike Eagle. And then there's this guy. No, so Madlib is a producer who most people know from things like Mad Villain.
Yeah.
He was invited to, so Blue Note is a celebrated record label full of jazz artists. And he was invited to take their catalog and kind of pillage it to create his own album out of it. And so there's an album called Shades of Blue, Madly Invades Blue Note, that I really love.
My alternatives, again, like, I think I had a hard time nailing down, like, what mood am I in when I'm trying to decompress?
Yeah.
So, you know, if I'm a little bit on the edgier or angrier side, I'm probably picking up, I could even be picking up Deftones, which I was like, should I go really? And then I was like, no, it's probably not appropriate. But definitely like shoegazy, maybe My Bloody Valentine, you know, where it's just like, I just want a wall of sound in my headphones.
Yeah.
And then I think along those lines, if I want that, but I want it to be not quite as, you know, distortion-y, then I probably would pick up like Beach House. Beach House. I mean, let's be honest, any interchangeable record of Beach House is probably going to give you about the same experience. But, you know, if I had to pick one, I'd probably pick like Teen Dream. Which would be great for this. Or, you know, if it really is just I'm looking to relax, I think that's maybe that would be a good distinction, is like decompressing versus relaxing.
Yeah, I could see that.
You know, I also thought like Bon Iver would be great, especially, sure. You know, for Emma Forever ago. But I don't know. I mean, I think there's so many different directions you could go with this, really.
Yeah. I mean, like D'Angelo's, all of D'Angelo's records, but especially Black Messiah.
Yeah.
I would immediately grab, you know, reach for if I was going for something relaxing. We should definitely do a best album for relaxing. We'll have to find a way into it that's a little more specific than that.
Yeah, right.
Just need a reason to talk about D'Angelo at some point.
But like, if I was going to pick alternatives for the kind of decompression where how I defined it,
yes,
I would probably like, I think I've reached a lot for Boxer by the National for that kind of thing. I think I've reached a lot for, I mean, honestly, a lot of Radiohead. It kind of depends on which album. I think I've also one honorable mention I definitely want to shout out is one of my favorite albums, Hurry Up, We're Dreaming by M83.
Yeah.
Right. All of those have definitely kept me company on the train ride home many years past.
All their whole catalog is full of albums like that. It's great. Yeah. All right. Before we go, what do you listen to this week?
Speaking of atonal, I told you to pick up the new Water From Your Eyes album, Everyone's Crushed, that just came out. I had heard a few tracks of this before it came out and was really enjoying it. And I've definitely been enjoying the album, although you found it way too atonal, which I did not see coming. Yeah. It's experimental and basically like experimental alternative, but like in a way that I find really fun and different. It definitely is like dissonant plenty and atonal plenty, but in a way that still works for me.
Nice.
Yeah.
Yeah. I'm going to keep going with it, but bumped up against those first couple tracks.
Yeah, I hear that.
I had a 30 seconds in, like, I get it.
Yeah, exactly.
Experience.
It's not for everyone. I want to put it out there. Like, this is one of those things that I would suggest that is definitely not going to resonate with everyone. It takes, you need some entry points.
My album this week that I've been listening to a lot is, so I'm going to Riot Fest in the fall. And I have been kind of lurking through the playlist that Riot Fest put out of all of the different bands, because I don't know a lot of them. And I didn't know 100 Jex. I don't even know if I'm saying the name right. But 100 Jex is like this 90s throwback, like kind of punk pop throwback that I really, really am digging. And so they have an album called 10,000 Jex. And I've been listening to that a little bit this week. But my true answer is that I got into a Melancholy and Infinite Sadness place.
Really?
I don't know what, I mean, I was in my hometown, so that probably is why. Melancholy was one of my go-to, like, deal with life records. And the song Galapagos has never been, like, a standout on the record for me. But for some reason, when it got to Galapagos this time, it hit, and I just had it on repeat for, like 4 or 5 times through. I just could not get enough of that song. So Galapagos is my like Dave's 90s throwback.
That's fascinating.
Pick of the week. Yeah.
I also listened to a lot of Melancholy as an angsty teenager in my hometown. So I hear that.
Yeah.
But isn't it like crazy and kind of beautiful that like sometimes you'll hear something that you've heard plenty of times before and it will just hit different.
Yeah.
And it'll just hit different. And all of a sudden it will have a completely different meaning. I love that about music.
Yeah, that's a cool experience, especially when it's something that you like grew up with. Like, I know the words to Galapagos. Like, it's not like the first time I've heard it, but for some reason it just hit different this
time. You just like circumstantially, you're in a different headspace and you hear it differently.
It does make me, I mean, I don't have time to do this, but it does make me wonder how many records I've kind of like, you know, kind of shrugged off as I've listened to them the first time, where if I went back to them in a different headspace, I might find them to be, I mean, that certainly happened. Just, you know, from time to time anyway, but I've never done it on purpose where like I've gone back and tried to listen to like Pitchfork's top tens for like the last 20 years or something. Like I wonder how many of those records that I kind of shrugged off at the time, I would be really into in my, you know, 2023 version of Dave.
I think we've talked about this before. Like I have a pretty common experience of records that are inaccessible to me at first or like take a little bit more effort to get into.
Yeah,
always end up being more rewarding over the long term in terms of my affection for them than the ones where I've found an immediate entry point listen to the entire thing, enjoy the entire thing, those tend to have no staying power for me.
That's interesting. I could see that, especially when it's like the poppy stuff. Like, there's stuff that's like immediately really fun, but then I just never go back to it. Not because it's bad. I just never, you know, I just find myself kind of like, well, that was really fun for a season. And then I just kind of forget about it.
Exactly. Exactly. Yeah. Or sometimes I look back and I go, oh, actually, that wasn't good.
Oh, yeah, that's happened.
I've had that experience, too.
Incubus was my favorite band for 10 years. I do sometimes wish that we could redo top 10 lists like halfway through the next year. Like I find that my list that I put out at the end of the year on like Instagram or whatever is never what I'm actually listening to 5 or 6 months later. So if I redid my top five right now, it would, there'd probably be a couple things that would still be on there, but for the most part, it would be, you know, three new albums and those three, you know, not three new albums that I've listened to since then, but just three albums that I listened to last year. Didn't click as fully, but I found myself coming back to more.
I find that when I'm making my end of year, like what are the best albums from this year, I will inevitably stumble upon things where I'm like, oh yeah, I loved that album. Why didn't I listen to that more?
Yeah. I sometimes overrate those. I sometimes like, I'll toss something in my top five that like I really only started listening to in the previous 3 weeks because it's just new and exciting. I'm like, this is the best. And then, you know, 6 months later, I was like, I listened to that for those 3 weeks. And that was it.
Well, what I find is that, I mean, speaking of things needing a slow burn to really gain my affection, sometimes that's what happened. Like I will listen to it one time and be like, I really love this, but I can't spend a lot of time with it right now.
Yeah.
For whatever reason.
Yeah. I can see that. I can see that. All right. Well, start making your list because next week we are doing the should we do our top five or should we do our best album? Maybe we can figure this out off the air.
Maybe. Maybe we shouldn't do it right now while everyone's listening.
All right. I'll see you next week.
Bye.